Hi everyone, welcome back to theCUBE's live coverage of Okta Oktane here in Las Vegas. I'm your host, Rebecca Knight, alongside Jackie McGuire, my co-host and analyst. This is your jam, authentication, you love this stuff.
I've been writing about identity for a handful of months, pretty hardcore, so I have to admit I'm in a nerd's paradise.
All right, well, welcome to nerd's paradise, and welcome to our next guest, Shiv Ramji, president of Otho at
Thank
Okta.
You.
Thank you so much for coming on the show.
Appreciate it.
So let's do a big picture setup for our viewers. You have said that AI isn't just changing what we build, but also how we build.
Yeah.
Talk a little bit about that and what feels fundamentally different for developers right now.
Yeah, so when we say AI is changing what we build and how we build, what we mean is, so today when you build applications, they are very deterministic. I'll just give you an example because we all travel. So say for instance, you use the American Airlines app to travel here. What you can do once you log in inside the application is finite. It's predetermined. And so you're always going to go down known paths, and that's how you control access to data, right? So that's your control point. When you enter the world of AI, especially when AI is conversational, it's non-deterministic. It can do long-running tasks, it can work in the background, and frankly, can take any input, right? Because it's just natural language. So that very nature of how AI applications are built, or what generative AI and agents can do, you have to rethink how you build your applications. Because you can no longer control the access point inside your application. In fact, I bet you a year from now, when you use the American Airlines application and if it has a natural language interface to it, it's going to look very different and you'll be able to do a whole lot more things than what you can do today. So the implication here is the your typical three-tier architecture where you kind of have the data layer, your business logic and presentation changes fundamentally. And what happens is your presentation layer is now the access point. So that's a pretty big change in how applications basically are going to be built. Then about what's changing with what you build, lots of differences there too. So for example, now the new mandate for everybody is like you are trying to bring AI into your product. And it's not just some feature, but it's really about an internal, it might be an internal co-pilot, might be a smarter workflow, or might be a chatbot, right? So you're trying to bring AI into the product. And the second thing is you have to now make your products AI ready. And what I mean by that is now your products have to talk to other agents, other systems, other APIs. Well, that's a whole new set of security concerns. And so those are the two big things. If you're a builder of applications now, when you think of these two trends, it's like, wow, that's a pretty big shift, right? And so now your security concerns, your security perimeter has changed drastically. And I think the proof of kind of what's happening here is in all the headlines, if you look at the last few months, when you've heard of like, chatbots going rogue and having access to information, data leakage, right? So I think these concerns are no longer hypothetical, this is happening now. And we were already experiencing it.
So with Auth0, generally your clientele has been developers and engineers, right? So generally the people behind the scenes who are building the apps. And now I think with generative AI and with things like Claude and the ability for normal people to build these things, how do you view, because I think one of the things we were all thinking about when the Okta acquired Auth0 is these are two very different customer bases. But now it seems like AI is enabling them to merge, cross over. So how do you think about that in the sense of, Okta's always been this great platform for being able to sign in once, get access to all your work apps.
Yes.
And so how do you bring that, cross app access and things like that? How do you think about the merger between the Okta interface and the Auth0 interface?
Yeah, I think the beauty about this new world is, and kind of how we serve them is, we're really focused on builders. And so we're doing everything we can to give builders everything they need from a standards first perspective. So if you're an engineer, developer, and you've built your application, or AI agent, or chatbot, whatever it is that you're building, if it's built with Auth0, you're going to get all of these standards out of the box, right? And then if that application is now being consumed within the boundaries of an enterprise or a company, and if you're using Okta to manage access to your employees and in terms of applications they can access, now you already have all of the security standards and capabilities built in. So there is no further configuration required. You don't have to change your applications. IT teams don't have to go do five other things. They're like, oh, this applications, we say these apps are going to be fabric ready. Mm-hmm. What we mean by that is they come with standards, and so when you are now in the hands of an IT admin who's trying to configure these applications, they know that they're going to get the full security benefit in terms of, you know, session protection or really all of the identity threats that you have, they can protect against them.
So rather than at the Auth0 level having to figure out what level of access someone that this app should have to Salesforce and to, you know, your HR platform,
yeah,
you can basically give it, map that access to the user and make sure that no user can use an agent to do something that they wouldn't have been able to do on their own, correct?
I think you just nailed it, yeah. So we do two things. One, through the Auth0 platform, we allow you to make it easy for builders to connect their agents to other applications, right? But once you, as a user, if you're using that agent, you can only get to access to specific resources in that app based on your permissions. So there are two parts here. One is just connecting the agent to the app. Then, what can you have access to through that agent inside the app? And that's truly determined by kind of what your permissions are.
So how, one of the things that Todd McKinnon talked about on the main stage today was this tension that frankly, leaders like he feels, but also leaders of teams and smaller teams, that to be innovative and to, but also to be secure. He said something like, if I'm not building a trillion dollar AI company, what am I doing with my life? And I feel like a lot of us feel that.
That way, yeah.
So how do you manage that tension within your team?
So everything that we are doing, so we do lots of experiments and labs and tests. These are not production environments, right? So we learn in those environments. And we have to keep up, especially my team and my organization, we have to keep up with everything that's going on with AI, right? And there is a breakthrough of some sort almost every week. And that's kind of what we saw last year when you know, this generative AI experience is coming out, we were the first to spot that, wow, security is actually going to be a problem. So we actually announced a developer preview last year and said, hey, talking to all the users and customers, there are four requirements that are critical for agents to work successfully. And so we put our product out in developer preview, and it's been a good place to learn and talk to real enterprises, real use cases. And we have seen some of those use cases develop. And once we validate, that's when we bring these products to market. So that's one. The second thing we do is we also use our own products internally. So all of the apps that we're building, that, you know, Oktane registration, for example, is built using Okta. We have internal initiatives where we're using our own fine-grained authorization product to solve the data governance problem. So we use these products ourselves to kind of first understand, are we solving the needs? Are there unintended consequences before we take this out to market? And so that's a way to kind of mitigate this notion of like, we can innovate, learn within our own labs, and we're not putting something out there too quickly. And then also we incubate all of these products through our beta periods and early access periods, which, and developer preview, which we did in this case to make sure that what we're building kind of meets the need of a really rapidly evolving market.
Well, can you talk a little bit about those use cases and how developers are using these identity fundamentals to build apps in like healthcare or finance or?
Yeah, so there are four key requirements across all of these industries that kind of are common. So first is very basic. Just like you have to authenticate and validate who you are, we have to do that for agents. But there is something unique here. We need to make sure that not only is the agent authenticated, but the agent is authenticated on behalf of you. Mm-hmm. So that linkage is super important. Then the second thing is, I talked about how these agents have to connect to different applications. And depending on use case, an agent will have to connect to 30, 40, 50 different applications securely. And that's really burdensome for builders and developers. So what they have told us is like, there is no way I can go configure each and one of these connections for every single agent that I'm building. There's got to be a better way. So agents need to talk to different applications via APIs, and you need to do that securely. So that's kind of the second requirement. The third requirement is, while agents are powerful, and we want them to do all kinds of stuff for us, there are sensitive transactions. A good example would be, if an agent is making a purchase on your behalf, I think you may want to be in the loop to say, is this amount right, and are you purchasing the right thing, right? Or maybe if you ask an agent to go build you a travel itinerary, where you're going to spend thousands of dollars and your family's traveling with you, you probably want to review that before the agent makes a purchase. So we believe right now, at least in this stage of the evolution, our customers and the agents they're building, they will need human intervention or human verification. So we call this like human in the loop. And the last thing is all about data security and permissioning. I had mentioned how the way apps are being built are changing. You have a lot more surface here that is exposed to attacks. Your data, your APIs are now exposed, right? So how do you control access to that? You need finer grained permissioning. So these are the four requirements that are fairly common across all industries and across most agentic use cases. So the product that we've built is really addressing these four key requirements. And then obviously we'll learn from that and continue to build on top of that.
One of the things you talked about yesterday in the analyst sessions, and we've heard quite a bit from a lot of the leadership, both at Auth0 and Okta, is this concept of building frameworks and kind of trying to lead the way in terms of that. Because it seems like, I know I, as a early data scientist, I was making all of these hard-coded token mistakes and things like that. I just didn't know better. And at the time, there really wasn't a framework or guidance or anything like that to tell me how to do better. So can you talk a little bit about that and about, you know, why Okta's chosen to get deeply involved in this framework and guidance process?
Yeah, there are two parts to this. So the first one is the investments we're making in standards with many others in the industry. We're not the only ones, but we certainly care about it a lot because of security outcomes. So that is one big investment. The second investment is, look, builders and engineers and developers, they are not security experts. And I don't think it's fair for us to expect them to be. So this is where the capabilities that we're building, we're taking that burden away. So we are identity experts. We know how to secure tokens, vault them and scope them. So we're going to take that burden, and then we make it really easy for a developer to use our products and APIs so they don't have to think about, you know, leaking credentials, storing tokens in clear text in their code. We take away that burden. And so those are the two ways we're making it really easy so that, you know, developers want to build value and they want to build the next cool thing in innovation. We don't need them to be security experts.
So finally, as we wrap up, how do you see the relationship between AI and identity evolving in terms of what the developer tomorrow needs to know that the developer of today, it might not be as important?
So these are my prediction and future casting a little bit. I don't know which ones will be accurate, but I can imagine, you know, today I talked about those four key requirements and kind of the products we're launching. One interesting bit in there is consent. Mm-hmm. And I think you will see when we do our demos and we talk about our products, you will see a lot of consent screens. Like, yes, I allow you to do that, or I allow this app to access information. I think we'll have to solve the consent problem. So when you think of AI and identity, I think consent is something that we have to think about solving. It's not just a security thing. It's also a very annoying end user thing. I mean, imagine, we already complain about those GDPR cookie boxes, don't we, right?
Yeah.
Like, it's annoying, right? Now imagine you had to do that 70 times in a day for every single app and interaction.
Feels like I already do.
On the other side though, so there was a demo you showed yesterday where it was like, oh, you don't have access to this thing. Let me request it from your manager. And I was like, no! I don't want my manager to know.
Exactly.
So maybe the user needs to be able to tweak that consent a little bit.
That's also true. You will need flexibility with how you present the consent. So I think there is a user experience component. So I think consent is a category that's really interesting. Another category that I think about, you know, we are thinking about permissions. So I think data security is a really hairy problem here that I think when you think of AI and identity, I think identity will play a role in that. Third would be, you know, it's really hard for humans to distinguish what is AI versus human, right? And you would think, well, machines are good at it. They're having a hard time too. So I think, how do you verify that someone is who they say they are? So identity verification is going to be a very interesting problem. It's already a problem now because you can see all kinds of problems such as fraud, that you know, product fraud and product abuse that you're seeing. So I think that's going to be an interesting area. I think we will have to solve for that. And then the last one, which is really going out there, is that all of these AI tools are essentially building memory. If you're using ChatGPT or using Perplexity, they have the history of all the questions you've asked. Well, I know all of us are using different tools. It's going to be annoying if you have to go to every new tool and kind of share all the research, all the questions you've asked. So I think at some point, memory will need to be portable, and it's going to be linked to your identity. So those are kind of some of the areas that I think we will see an evolution in some way. And my bet is identity will have a role in it.
Well, we are going to check your work when we're back here at Octane 2026. Exactly. So Shiv, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Rebecca Knight for Jackie McGuire. Stay tuned for more of theCUBE's live coverage of Okta Oktane. You're watching theCUBE, the leader in enterprise tech news and analysis.